Well, good morning, Rem. You're considered worldwide as a very important person with your views and visions. And that's why we were extremely glad to have you as one of the key speakers for the 14th Docomomo Conference. Mm-hmm. Sadly, you had to cancel the appointment a few weeks ago. We're extremely happy that we can have this conversation, but please tell the audience a bit about why you can't come.
I am really deeply sorry that I couldn't come, because I would have loved to address the preservationists in general and as a kind of typology. I've never done it, so I was really excited and honored to be able to do it. But sometimes kind of real architectural life interferes with intellectual architectural life. And this is one of those cases. So I'm really deeply sorry, but I had no choice.
Okay, thank you very much. Now, your vision fits the ideas of the modern tradition. Can you tell me what, for you, are the most important characteristics of modernity, of the idea of modernity?
I think that it is true that I am kind of really a product of modern architecture. The reason I became an architect are totally kind of related to the modern architecture of the kind of 20s and 30s, and of course that was an architecture that was not only concerned with intellect, with visual or aesthetic issues, but that also had a kind of social program. And I think it is kind of really architecture as a profession that can accommodate but also change life, and that has to offer more than lifestyles, but perhaps kind of radically different ways of living, is what appealed to me most in terms of my motivation to become an architect. When I actually was an architect, when I finished studies and kind of finished writing the book, I launched myself in a world that was deeply unsympathetic to that kind of position.
That's correct.
And in a way, I could say that I became an architect when it was too late for the kind of architecture I wanted to do. Because suddenly the market economy was declared by a kind of incomprehensible consensus to be the ultimate mediation between reality and ambition. So I've been therefore kind of shifting my interest away from, let's say, modernity as a kind of visual language, to the effects of the kind of market economy and globalization on architecture and on the kind of production of the cities. And as you know, I'm now looking at the countryside. So from a participant with a kind of relatively optimistic and simple mission, I think I've become kind of more an observer.
But you still believe in the idea of progress?
Yeah, but an observer that is burdened with a lot of very unfashionable and old-fashioned preoccupations, ideals.
But you still, I mean, you concentrate your ideas on inventions and the way inventions can be used to, you know, make a better life.
So I have a kind of double life in that sense here. Yes, so I've become an observer in kind of general terms, and of course I can remain an architect. And we've tried to, as you kind of suggest, invent and kind of maintain a kind of faithfulness to that ambition of offering different ways of living.
Yeah. Am I right in thinking that your vision has been adapted, has been changed?
Well, I hope so, because I'm kind of reactive kind of person, and I think that we have been kind of living through an incredibly fast-changing kind of world. We are now in a kind of situation that the word disruptive has become kind of almost an honorable word. And so obviously I had to change kind of very drastically my my values.
Yes, yes. That's fascinating to to notice, because you are an outspoken person and you are rather influential. It's interesting to note that, you know, it's at least to my mind it's much more open and much more diverse, because you introduce preservation in your way of thinking now, the idea of recognizing linear history. That combined with trying to make a livable city is extremely important.
I'm not so sure. We are more open, or I'm more open, but in the sense that kind of obviously I always was very interested in history, and also always was very interested in the issue of preservation, but I think that partly due to the fact that I had this journalistic background, I can look at the things that seem to be most acute and look at the problems that seem to be most acute.
Yeah. Now, you've written a lot about urban planning and the future of the city. Mm-hmm. Can you elaborate a bit on the main problems facing the city today?
Partly because I had a very early experience in a different continent. I think that I was able to look at cities without the burden of Europeanness, and without looking at every city in terms of the European city, and comparing every city to the European city, and then find it wanting. Mm-hmm. I think that has been kind of one of the kind of really problematic issues in architecture, that we have way too long continued to look from a kind of Western perspective. And that therefore, if you look at the discourse in the kind of 80s, 90s, we were obliged to kind of reject almost any other alternative because of our deep nostalgia for the European values of composition, coherence, kind of patterns, etc. So my main insight, I think, has been that we should not look at modernism, not necessarily look at modernity, but look at modernization, because that seems to me the big story of the kind of last kind of 30, 40 years, an enormous effort of global modernization that takes kind of many, many different shapes, that has also helped an enormous amount of kind of people. If you look, for instance, in China, kind of so many million, hundreds of millions that were pulled out of kind of poverty, but that, on the other hand, has had as its consequence that cities have become completely unrecognizable, can no longer be controlled with the same apparatus that we with the same apparatus that we have so far developed, and that also architecture has become a kind of much more casual kind of effort.
Yeah, but things are, you're talking about progress also, in the fact that the public sector is disappearing, and the private sector is rapidly taking over.
Yeah,
and therefore, the whole idea of individualization of collectivity is becoming into danger.
Yeah. So that I don't kind of really call progress. In that sense, I've always considered myself kind of really a critical voice. I think that the status of architecture has been kind of really seriously compromised by the disconnection from the public sector and the kind of intense, more and more intense relationship with the private sector. And of course, we didn't have a lot of choice, but that has clearly happened. I see signs of dissatisfaction kind of everywhere. So I guess there is maybe the beginning of a kind of rebalancing where people kind of recognize that the kind of public sector remains completely essential in order to define aims.
How do we get to a more positive situation where this public space becomes public again, becomes of everybody, and recognizable and friendly, you know, as you call it, the livable city. Is preservation, for example, and adaptive reuse, can that help?
I think obviously it can help, but I think that one important thing is, I think, not to be hysterical. I think under the market economy, I think there is a kind of exaggeration of arguments where basically many kind of solutions are offered as solutions to disasters. I don't think of that kind of shift more as a kind of physical shift, but more as a shift in mentality or in culture. That kind of once that happens, we will be able to inhabit the same environments in a kind of more positive way. And so in that sense, again, I look at architecture in a modest way of not necessarily being able to make all the difference. The crucial difference is really made by culture, clearly, and by politics.
So are you then talking about the topic which you showed in Koolhaas as well, which is trying to find a sort of coexistence between radical change and radical status?
Koolhaas was kind of really a polemic. We looked around and we were surprised, to say the least, that there was so much preservation going on, and that preservation, you know, has such a kind of incredibly kind of political force and political strength. And so when we counted, we came to this kind of surprising conclusion that 12% of the world is to some extent under a kind of regime of preservation, which is partly only good, you know, kind of, I'm kind of very happy that a certain kind of nature preserves kind of exist there. But of course, it's also kind of naive. You know, kind of what maybe the main naivety of preservation is that they do not realize that preservation is change also, and so therefore that they are actually kind of part of, and that is perhaps the most difficult, but also for me the most exciting discovery. Once I kind of really started looking at preservation and at the roots of preservation, the beginning of preservation, to discover that it actually was part of the initial waves of modernization that were kind of launched by maybe the kind of French Revolution, the Enlightenment, etc. So that, you know, it enabled me to look at preservation not as the counterpart of modernization, but as a kind of very special chapter or component of modernization.
That's correct.
Which is, in a way, very logical. If you want to change everything, you also have to decide what you do not want to change.
Because the whole idea of capitalism, of the Industrial Revolution, is permanent change. Because otherwise it doesn't work. So, as a counterbalance, obviously you start to try to keep things.
So it makes perfect sense. But I think that so therefore in our kind of thinking about preservation, yes, we're interested in, you know, we had a kind of agenda. And maybe an important part of the agenda was to find a way that you do not only have to preserve the masterpiece, the exception, the kind of historical thing, but that also you create a kind of situation where generations after you are able to understand and to some extent to reconstruct what happened before them.
Yeah.
That seemed, yeah. And that maybe again is a kind of modest ambition, that you don't have to be kind of intimidated by the kind of greatness of earlier generations, but that at least you understand your own position in relationship to earlier generations.
Yeah, so you appreciate the sort of linear history.
Another part, which we haven't been able to kind of really kind of realize, is to also really recognize that architecture has changed a lot, that kind of since the commercial has become perhaps the most important kind of value. Our buildings recognize that and are no longer necessarily kind of aesthetic constructs, but more commercial constructs, whose logic at some point expires, and expires quite quickly.
Yeah.
And so, you know, what we thought is, yes, it's a good idea to preserve, maybe it's a good idea to preserve a lot, but also find a logic and a way to then kind of destroy or then at least declare that kind of certain parts of what we built and therefore certain parts of our recent production should be, you know, is conceived as temporary and therefore
sure.
also need to be eliminated and make room for new stuff.
You're absolutely right. Mm. I mean, how do we get rid of the junk?
Yeah.
But let's first talk about the essence of preservation.
Yeah.
I mean, if you would try to formulate why do we need preservation in this rapidly changing time?
Well, so
what's the essence?
I try to say it for me, preservation is productive to the extent that it allows later generations to understand
yes.
history.
Yeah.
And that, obviously, you can understand history in many ways, and it doesn't mean that you kind of have to keep everything, but at least there should be some kind of ways for interested people to reconstruct where they came from.
Yeah.
And
does it have to do with identity or?
To some extent, it has to do with identity, but for instance, it's very important. We travel a lot, kind of, and if you travel, it is a kind of significant experience. If you can travel to a place where you again kind of recognize where they came from, the development has been, kind of, etc. And so, if you kind of remove those kind of elements from the beginning entirely, then it becomes kind of much sadder experience and much less kind of rich.
Yeah.
So it's not only for your own identity, but also to understand the kind of intricacy of the world and the intricacy of all these cultures that are interacting with
and
each
migrating
other.
Migrating and sort of moving around.
Yeah.
So isn't it so that recognizing your environment and making a sort of, you know, love-hate relationship with it is extremely important for future cities.
Yeah.
Because the generic city is dramatic.
I think that I would say no, because I think the generic city is kind of really literally the outcome of a kind of very blatant observation. That we need to construct, simply because it's shift to cities, we need to construct enormous amounts of kind of urban substance that can not be done kind of literally with the kind of carefulness and kind of meaning that we were able to inject kind of before. Because before a king could ask Michelangelo to kind of work 20 years on kind of something, that's kind of simply out of the question today. So we need to stop moaning and need to kind of recognize that the generic city also has qualities. And I one of the qualities is it doesn't demand a lot of attention. You look in kind of what to them. It's also a form of freedom because you don't have to recognize this happened here, that happened there, this is kind of beautiful, this is it. So okay.
Now
and I think that the moaning about the generic city is, I think, the
it's moaning against reality.
No, not only against reality, it's kind of basically the West moaning about its loss of influence and its and moaning about its being toppled as kind of top of the hierarchy.
Mm-hmm. That brings me to the thing you propose at Chronochaos, and that is, you propose there to say, well, let's freeze particular neighborhoods, so we preserve them, and then we keep them the same, and then from there, that gives us the freedom to
change everything else,
and gives the architects the possibility to create cities again.
Yeah.
Is that a blunt statement? Because it's very much against the idea of
change,
organic organic change.
Yeah. Well, I think that the word organic you can kind of basically eliminate from your vocabulary, because I think that is exactly the point of our current kind of moment. Nothing is organic and everything is artificial, and kind of basically the kind of speed of transformation, you know, means the end of the organic and the end of the natural and therefore the end of the plant. So I was, it is of course to some extent a kind of theoretical idea, but I meant it kind of, for instance, if you look at the city of Rome, there is a number of kind of ruins inside and the ruins almost have a kind of quality of a point grid.
Mm-hmm.
And even though they don't function, and even though they don't contribute to the kind of economy and are clearly not inhabited, if you interpret them as kind of sections that are preserved, not reused, but kind of simply let to decay, they are extremely meaningful in the kind of overall climate of Rome and the overall condition. And so my only, interest was to find kind of more abstract ways and more random ways in a way to look at the issue of preservations, that rather than argue for particular kind of qualities, where you're always kind of blinded by your own prejudice,
yes.
Could we not kind of find kind of random kind of zones of preservation as a kind of counterpart to this constant transformation?
Now, take Amsterdam, for example. The city of Amsterdam, the center of Amsterdam, the 17th century center of Amsterdam, is World Heritage.
Mm.
So, in principle, it's fixed.
Mm.
But in practice, it isn't, and you can't, because if you freeze it, I mean, it's terrible, because nothing stays the same. And that, in my option, it means the world organic. I mean, things change continuously. So it's not so much how do we keep it the same. In my mind, it's more how do we keep it safe.
Yeah.
And in Holland, we have this idea, as far as preservation is concerned, conservation through development. So,
which is also more or less the kind of UNESCO point of view.
Well, they're beginning to move to that. And I think that's a very practical way of solving this sort of problem. And that means that you know, it is piecemeal.
Yeah.
And the advantage of piecemeal, at least to my mind, is that it fits as much as possible into the fabric of the whole, like you do in Taipei, for example. You create something, the area around it stays the same, and you put something completely new, but it's not the vast area.
On top of it, yeah.
It's not the vast area. It's piecemeal. Is that, could that be a solution?
Well, I think, I mean, if you look at preservation kind of in general, one of the kind of perhaps more controversial discoveries, which hasn't really been kind of picked up by preservationists, is that kind of that if you have the graph of UNESCO kind of preservation and you look at the graph of Wall Street economy, the two totally coincide. Yeah. And that if you then look at the kind of increase of world tourism, that also turns out. I think the preservationists have not kind of recognized this this connection, but also they haven't recognized the tourism connection. And I think that that is the Achilles heel of preservation, because almost always kind of UNESCO World Heritage kind of sites become the kind of preferred sites of tourism. And therefore you can also say that World Heritage recognition is the beginning of a death sentence, that where authenticity is disappearing almost as a given. And so I would still, for instance, question whether Amsterdam benefits from being declared World Heritage, or whether over time it will kind of suffer from it.
It's suffering already.
So
because of the enormous amounts of tourists.
The enormous amount.
They can't solve it. You say that preservation needs a theory, and it's dramatically lacking.
Would you agree with that?
I don't think you can make it a theory. Mm-hmm. We've developed all sorts of methodologies, ways of thinking,
tools,
mm-hmm. and ways of thinking, mm-hmm. but it is too diverse to arrive at a theory. We try to, coming into the point you make between the icon or the exceptional and the generic, we talk about the icon and the ordinary, and it's particularly now the ordinary, which you know is of our interest, which is the basis, adaptive reuse is the basis of our conference. Now, my point is, for this talk, what do you, you know, what would be the essence of keeping part of the generic? Because that is very complicated. With an icon, It's very simple, because you can go back to the original idea of the designer, back to the original materials, all this sort of stuff.
Well, I tried to do it in Moscow with the garage.
Yeah,
you know, there I kind of we took a master restaurant designed by a Soviet architect in the kind of 60s, and it was a total ruin, and turned it into something that could be used as a museum, and simply therefore kind of recognizing that Soviet architecture had a real commitment to the public in terms of scale and in terms of welcoming kind of people and not excluding them. And there we were also able to preserve part of the decay. You know, I don't know, you probably haven't seen it yet, but so there were kind of murals that were and walls that had mosaics. We really preserved the walls with all the damage and even kind of some of the graffiti that had been kind of added to it. So it's a real attempt to preserve something which everyone would consider mediocre, to preserve its kind of really most amazing or most pure ambition, i.e. to welcome large number of people and to therefore maintain both something of the ideology and of the aesthetic of that kind of period. And what is kind of really surprising is how well it works in terms of contemporary art. Yeah, people were very worried about it, of course, in the beginning. You know, what if you leave a Soviet mural, how does it work with Louis Bourgeois? Yeah. But actually, it works incredibly well, and you see that this whole kind of purification that we've had with the white cube in the contemporary museum And the elimination of context is actually not necessarily doing a good thing for the works of art. So, of course, that is the whole point of preservation, to try to preserve context, yeah, and to therefore give
and meaning.
Yeah, and therefore give something additional to to the contemporary.
There's an interesting paradox. Mm. There's on the one hand the time lapse of 50 years before you begin to appreciate what is important and what is not, and on the other hand, the urge of the preservationist to fix things as soon as it's ready. And you talked about that as well in
showed that it's getting shorter and shorter this kind of interval. But I mean, I see it slightly differently. I think that the connection between, let's say, icons and the preservation of icons, that's getting shorter and shorter. But the that implies that kind of everything which is not an icon is therefore unprotected.
Yes.
And at the mercy of of elimination.
Now, and how would we get that changed? Because I agree with it, the generic is extremely important. Mm. Part of it is junk. Mm-hmm. Well, get rid of it. Mm. But part of it could help us to bring the linear idea of history back.
Yeah.
To reintroduce a meaning, to give people again the sense of the social involvement, the public involvement in architecture and in urban planning. Mm. But how do we do that? Because that's obviously what us as Docomomo.
I think that maybe Docomomo is kind of working too much on, and that would be a kind of recommendation on objects and not enough on discourse.
Okay.
Because I think that kind of one of the weird kind of situations in the moment is that you can. Actually change things with words in a kind of really easy way because of all the social media kind of television I think you can really make a very compelling kind of argument for it and of course that's what I was hoping to do in your conference and maybe I can do it in a different conference but I think there has to be kind of simply more rhetoric and more communication because I still think that the architecture profession, although it has a kind of popularity now and kind of design is completely incorporated in the kind of most intimate parts of our life, it's very rare that you hear an argument for or a compelling kind of new insight that is broadcast in a kind of eloquent way. I mean, I think we have to, for that reason, be much more political in our behavior.
That's right. Huh? That's right. You touch our Achilles heel.
Hmm? Yeah.
Because we are involved in education. We are involved in the profession. Mm. But we are not able, for one or another reason, to lift it above that level and get involved in politics. Mm-hmm. I want to move on to your UNESCO idea. May I just quote you what you were writing at Konokkeos? If the empire of preservation continues to grow, it needs its own opposite, a domain of permanent change. And this is why you introduced the AMO convention concerning the demolition of world cultural junk. Uh-huh. Please tell me more about it. I think it's a fascinating subject.
Well, the whole idea of deliberate destruction was part of a competition we did in Paris, I think in the 90s, where we were asked to continue the Grand Axe. So if this is the Arc de Triomphe, it's all the kind of then here was La Défense with kind of speckles in.
Yeah, it's all.
They wanted us to look at here, this area, because this was already full. And it was full of buildings kind of from the 60s, 70s and 80s. Kind of hideous kind of quality, totally incoherent, with a few really beautiful buildings that were exception. So basically we started really looking at, you know, what is this?
Yeah.
And is it because it is Paris, does it have the kind of right to exist forever, like this area? Or can you kind of simply treat this as a field where every occupation is temporary and where maybe kind of lasting only kind of 25 or 30 years?
Yeah.
And that was the kind of first instinct, you know, that rather than constantly expand, you could introduce this kind of territory or condition even in Europe.
And then
and so
take
then,
things done.
Yeah. And then we exactly then get things done. And then we thought, you know, that needs a kind of political framework to launch or to justify it. And then, therefore, as a kind of joke, we thought that it should be a UNESCO kind of sponsored way of looking at how you could destroy things legitimately.
Yeah, but it's an extremely valuable idea.
Yeah, and I think
because we always concentrate on things which are important to keep, but never about things which are important to leave.
To eliminate.
Yeah, to eliminate.
Yeah. So I think that if you look at like that, like China, you also understand what is going on. So again, it's a kind of Western moaning about kind of how badly they treat their past. Maybe this is what is happening in China.
And
maybe in that sense, kind of those kind of countries have something to say that we don't kind of recognize yet.
Well, but then we come to the balance again between the radical change and radical status.
Yeah.
Now, can we now come down to the more practical things?
Mm.
Showing us what your ideas of adaptive reuse is. And I would like to do that with the Fondazione Prada in Milan.
Mm. Well. The Fondazione Prada is kind of basically existed of a factory in the outskirts of Milan.
Yep.
And the factory dates from 1917. It was a distillery. And the Prada had bought it and wanted to turn it into the headquarters of their foundation. And then we agreed that it would be kind of too boring to kind of really turn yet another industrial space into a kind of cultural space.
Yep.
And so they agreed kind of very soon that we would not only maintain it, but also inject some new things and kind of perhaps take out some of the old stuff. And I think that therefore, we were also extremely lucky that it was not a monument, because I think that then we could never have done it. So it was kind of one of those efforts of working with mediocrity and trying to kind of give it a new condition. And then we renovated the whole thing and added two major kind of elements, a horizontal box and a kind of vertical tower. It was really a project that taught me a lot of interesting effects or interesting consequences that I had not predicted myself. For instance, it's only 2 weeks before the opening that I began to kind of realize that maybe the most important space of Fondazione Prada is the outside, not the inside. And to kind of realize that actually it's insane that we have thought of so many museums that don't even have any outside space and that are kind of simply concentrations of interior space.
Yeah.
I think the beauty of outside space is that you can look from a different point of view at culture or with less pressure and that you can kind of recover in a way kind of from the intensity. But also it showed us that kind of outside space is not very demanding, that you can be extremely simple and almost minimalistic, and it's still, it's kind of charged, you know, a few trees, a few chairs, some material kind of nuances, and it kind of works already even in the outskirts of Milan.
And you get a completely new experience. You know, the old thing is not the old thing any longer. It's become something completely different.
Well, I think that was because we always, and you know, I was always fascinated by the idea, and that was the kind of preservation idea. You know, when we looked at Beijing, we said, okay, you can introduce newness as a kind of point grid, you can introduce newness as a kind of wedge, or you can introduce newness as a barcode.
Yeah.
And so Prada is kind of really a barcode. And because new and old are always kind of juxtaposed, and so it's really the idea of the barcode.
I'm afraid we have to come to an end.
Okay.
And that's the last thing, and that is, you said the modernists made preservation look like nonsense, and here we are as Docomomo documenting and conserving their heritage.
Yeah.
What is your final advice to us, to Docomomo, as an organization?
Well, so one advice is to go beyond your kind of professional comfort zone. That's maybe the most important kind of advice.
Yeah. Come out of your cocoon. That's what you're saying.
Come out of your cocoon.
Yeah. Join the international polemic.
And maybe you should also, because the more of Docomomo is modern, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Maybe drop the more. I mean, because I think it would be kind of really exciting if you also got involved in palazzos or then
in practice, obviously, we all do.
Yeah,
we
all do.
But
I think it would be because you're trying to preserve a kind of endangered thing. Yeah, and you know, anyone dealing with endangered, you know, acquires this kind of moral conviction that they're doing
freakish.
Something.
Yeah.
But I think preservation is much bigger than, I think the issues are also much more fun.
Yeah. Great, thanks very much indeed.
Okay, good.
Thank you very much.
Okay.